Hi everyone and welcome again to a new video. This will be another one of my teardown and reassembly videos, and for this episode I have an HP ProDesk 600 G1 in the small form factor version as the victim. A few months ago I did a video where we had a better look at the tower version of the same model and generation, and in that video I gave that machine a CPU and GPU upgrade and turned it into a proper gaming PC. This time, for this video, I'll keep things a bit more simple and I will just do a proper disassembly, reassembly and perform some benchmarks. The ProDesk 600 G1 came to the market somewhere beginning 2014 and it was available with 4th generation Intel Core CPUs. I tried to find the exact model, which I have here using archive.org, but couldn't really find an exact match with the CPU, which is an Intel Core i5-4570. Looking at the page that was dated from September 2014, there was no model available with an i5, and a later page that got archived in April 2015 shows an i5-4590 to be available. Not sure why this is the case. Maybe it got positioned differently in Europe or someone performed an upgrade before I got this machine. Nevertheless, the design of this machine is very much in line with HP's professional or advanced line of business PCs from around 2015-2016. Even today, it still looks pretty nice to my ID. The machine feels very decent overall. You can see and feel that this is not an entry-level model, and HP really did their best to deliver quality here. Looking at the front of the machine, we can see the power button, a slim DVD drive, which I noticed that is typically missing on the product photos. My best guess is that there were versions which came without any DVD or CD drive, although I couldn't find them. Further, we have a blank slot for a 3.5-inch device, 2x USB 2, 2x USB 3 and front audio. At the back of the machine, we can find 2x PS2, gigabit Ethernet, 6 more USB ports, 2x DisplayPort, a serial port, VGA and audio as well. Our machine does not have any PCIe cards installed, and here we also have the power connector. To open up the case, you can use the latch and pull the cover upwards. Inside the machine, you immediately notice that there is enough room for everything. Here we have that slim DVD drive, a 240GB SSD, the power supply, a big heatsink with a CPU under it and a CPU fan, the memory and the PCIe slots. The drives are mounted in a separate drive cage, which can be tilted upwards for easy access. As you can see, here is also plenty of room. We could add another 3.5-inch drive on top here, another one under the DVD drive, and there is room for two 2.5-inch drives over here and where the SSD is currently installed. To get the DVD drive out, we better first remove the front cover of the case. Then, we can disconnect the cables and use the green latch to release the drive and slide it out towards the front. For the SSD as well, first I will remove the cables. Then we can release the drive and move it backwards to get it out. The installed SSD seems to be a Kingston SSD now of 240GB. This is definitely something that got installed later on and didn't come from HP, but it was a good upgrade. Now that we have these drives out, we can also remove the SATA cables. And while we are busy removing cables from the motherboard, let's continue with that. Here we have the front power button and LEDs, power command, power output for the SATA drives, power input from the power supply and P4 power input. Then the front USB 3 ports, front USB 2, the speaker, and finally the connector for front audio. The CPU cooler is pretty interesting here. Instead of the typical top-mounted fan on the CPU heatsink, HP opted for a bigger heatsink and a bigger fan that blows air through it front to back instead. This plastic piece here helps to properly guide the air for that. We can now also remove the memory. We have two modules of 4GB, and here as well, it does look that this got updated after it came from the factory, as we have two different modules. Let's get that heatsink off now as well. It's fixed with 4 Torx screws. After cleaning up both the CPU and heatsink and removing the old crusty thermal paste, we can have a better look at that heatsink. It even has some heat pipes on the side and a proper fan that will take care of the heat. Not something you would see in these typical SFF machines, but it feels solid. The last component that is fixed to the motherboard is the CPU. As I mentioned before and got confirmed now, we have an i5-4570 installed. This was more or less mid-range at the time that this machine was on the market, with 4 cores, 4 threads, running at 3.2 and up to 3.6 GHz, and with 6 MB of cache. We'll see in the benchmarks how this performs compared to the i7-4970, which I put in the tower version. Now that we got that one out, it's time to remove the motherboard from the case. First, we need to remove the 8 screws that fixes it to the case. And then we can get the board out of there. While the case is near empty, let's also take a good look at the power supply. 240 watt of maximum power output and 80 plus gold rated. Since we have that motherboard out, we can take a better look at it as well. Here we can find a CPU socket. We have 4 DIMM slots, color-coded for dual channels, power input and P4 power input, power output and power command, front button and LEDs, speaker, USB 3, 2 connections for USB 2, 4 SATA ports, management engine flash descriptor override, front audio, 3x PCIe X1 and a PCIe X16 slot, second serial port, parallel port, hood lock and hood sensor, system fan and CPU fan, CMOS battery, CMOS reset button, and finally the password reset jumper. Now, before we put everything back together, let's first take a look at all components we have here. Obviously, we have the motherboard, which we just took a look at, the SSD, DVD writer, heatsink and fan, the i5 CPU, and 2 4GB DDR3 DIMMs. Time to put things back together now. First, I'll put back the motherboard in the case. And once it is in place, we can fix it again. Typically, I would first insert the CPU before putting the board in the case, but here there is just so much room. It's very comfortable to do that once the board is already in there. We need to take care that the orientation is correct, and then we can just close up the socket. Before we put back that nice heatsink and cooler, let's also put some fresh thermal paste on the CPU. And then, as mentioned, we can reinstall that heatsink. We shouldn't forget to reconnect the fan as well. Then we can proceed with reinstalling the memory. We have 2 DIMMs, and as we want these to work in dual channel mode, it is important to first populate the black slots, which are DIMM 1 and 3. If I would use only 2 DIMMs like I do now, but put them in different colored slots, we would still be able to use 8GB, but it would have a negative impact on performance. All connectors can now go back to the motherboard as well. Including the 2 SATA cables for both our SSD and DVD drive. which we can then put back as well, starting with that 240GB SSD drive. Once it is back in place, we can connect it now to both power and the other end of the SATA cable. Followed by the DVD drive, which gets inserted from the front and then as well gets connected to power and SATA. Almost there. Before we close up the case, we need to put the front panel back first. The plastic piece, which makes sure there is a proper airflow for the CPU, goes back in as well. And then we can reinstall the top panel to close up the case. I hooked up everything to a monitor, keyboard and mouse, but it looks like the PC did not want to power up anymore. It didn't react at all to pressing the power button. And quickly, I did realize that I probably forgot to put back the front panel connector to the motherboard. After opening up the case, indeed, we can clearly see that this one was not connected, as I kind of tucked away the cable between some others. Let's get that connected again. Close everything up and give this another try. Ah, that looks better. Let me press F10 now in order to enter the BIOS setup. And in here, first, let's have a look at what system information has to say. We can see the i5-4570S CPU and both the 4GB DIMMs, operating in dual channel as we want it to be. In storage, device configuration, we can see both our SATA drives as well, the SSD and the DVD writer. As far as I know, the SSD that was installed was empty, so let's perform a fresh installation of Windows 11 on here. For that, I will insert a bootable Windows 11 USB drive and press F9 in order to enter the boot menu. Here we can then select the USB drive and launch the Windows 11 installation. In theory, this machine does not officially support Windows 11, but by bypassing the hardware checks like CPU generation and check for TPM 2.0, we can still get it installed. And it works just fine. I'll put a card here that points to a specific video I did on this subject in case you would be interested for more. After completing the installation, and also bypassing the need for a Microsoft account, I also installed all available Windows updates, including all drivers that were available. After quite a bit of waiting and a few reboots later, you can see that all updates got installed, and from here, let's have a look at the About info. As expected, same as we could see in the BIOS, Windows properly detects the CPU and memory as well. Time to see now how the system performs by running some benchmarks. As a first test, I will run a CPU benchmark from Geekbench 5. $899 single-core and $2942 multi-core. Pretty much in line with what I had in mind. But let's compare these cores to similar systems that I tested before with the same benchmark. I did a test with an Optiplex 3020 before, which I upgraded to this exact same CPU. It did score slightly worse in there with 2774 as core, compared to the 2942 we get now. Even compared to a 6th generation i5-6500T, which was in an Optiplex 7040 Micro, we get a better score. Good to see. Let's repeat this test now with Geekbench 6, which is the newest version. As I did before, I will also run the CPU benchmark here. In a previous video, we could also see that with this newer version of Geekbench, we should get a more real-life representable score for multi-core performance. And here we have the results. 1162 single and 3316 multi-core. Let's again compare this with those similar machines to get a good idea if these are as expected. The 3316 that we get on this machine is again slightly better than what we could get out of that same CPU on the Dell Optiplex 3020. And similar as with Geekbench 5, this machine again outperforms that i5-6500T as well. As a final test, let's see how that Kingston SSD performs. We seem to get around 455 MB per second write and up to 479 MB per second read speed out of it. About what you would expect for a SATA SSD, and really, SATA and not the SSD itself here is the bottleneck. That was it for the video. As you could see, this machine is just a decent and well-performing desktop machine that is still very usable today for everyday tasks like browsing, office work and watching videos. Another positive thing that I did notice during the testing was that the boot time of this hardware is really good. The footage you see now is at original speed and from a powered-off system to being fully available takes only around 10 seconds, which is a nice bonus. That was it for the video. Thanks a lot for watching, and as always, a thumbs up would be nice if you have enjoyed this video. If you have any remarks or questions, always welcome in the comments. And of course, feel free to subscribe if you like these kind of videos. Thanks again, and hope to see you back here soon.